All right, recording just started. So welcome everybody to the Dutch Closure Online Meetup number 139. If you're not familiar with this meetup, this means 139 consecutive months of closure meetups in the Netherlands, and since the COVID pandemic also on the interwebs. That's quite a few years, so you can do the math yourself. Tonight it's a special night in the sense that we do have an agenda. It's not the usual thing where I fail to provide an agenda for you and we have to invent something awesome to do together. We actually have an amazing talk tonight. Mathieu gracefully accepted the invitation to come and speak to us about I think a new tool that he has been working on, which is inspired by Riemann, as we discussed a little bit before the recording started. I think maybe Mathieu is much more able to present himself and the project than I would ever be. So Mathieu, if you want, the stage is yours, so please introduce yourself and the project.
Okay, so I will start. So again, thank you for the organization. Thank you to be here today. And I will talk about Mirabel. It's a stream processing engine written in Clojure. And Mirabel is a very popular fruit from the northeast of France, where I come from. You probably recognize my accent. I have a French accent. And so there is some echo, I think, or some noises. I don't know from where. I don't know where. Thank you. So let's start. First, who am I? My name is Mathieu Corbin. I'm a team lead at Exoscale. I'm a developer. I develop in Clojure since six years now. But I'm also coding in various languages like Golang, Java, Python, and so on. I'm using Emacs, and I maintain a couple of open source projects. You can check my website if you want to know more about these projects, and some of them are built in Clojure. I'm also a system administrator. I worked for a few years as a sysadmin and on things like automation, continuous integration, and continuous deployment, monitoring or distributed systems. Exoscale, quickly, what is it? It's an European cloud provider. We have six zones today in Europe, and we provide compute, so virtual machines and all the tooling which comes with virtual machines, snapshots, templates, and so on. Networking products, load balancers, private networks. We also have Kubernetes offerings, databases, an object store, etc., etc. It's a bit like Amazon Web Service or Google Cloud with a bit less services, but we are an European alternative. And at Exoscale, almost everything is done in Clojure. API gateways, for example, are written in Clojure. We wrote our orchestrators in Clojure. So, you know, in a cloud provider, you want to create a virtual machine, you want to create a load balancer, you want to create a Kubernetes cluster, and you have orchestrators driving all of that. And at Exoscale, all of these orchestrators are built with Clojure. We also have an object store, which is compatible with S3, which is also developed in Clojure, and we use Clojure everywhere, in our billing system, in stream processing engines. Our front end is also in Clojure scripts. So we rely a lot on Clojure, and we have tons of Clojure developers. But today, I'm not here to speak about cloud, but about Mirabel. And first, I would like to start with Riemann and talk a bit about this tool, which is a very popular project in the Clojure community. It's one of the projects, I think, on GitHub with the most star for Clojure. So what is Riemann? Riemann, it was created by Kyle Kingsbury. You maybe know him by its name, its surname Afir. It's an event processing system written in Clojure, mostly used for monitoring. I used Riemann in production. I still use it today a bit. And I contributed to Riemann a lot a couple of years ago at some point. And Riemann, it's a stream processing engine which will work on events. You will push events into Riemann, and Riemann will do stuff with them. And an event is, what is an event? It's a key, it's a map, it's an hash map, so keys and values. This is an example of an event with host, an host key with server one as value, a service key with a disk percent used, a state critical, for example, a time, so a timestamp attached to this event, a metric field, 90, a description, disk is full, tags, and a TTL, a time to live. So this event, for example, could be set by a monitoring agent, for example, running on your machine, on your servers, and this monitoring agent could report to Riemann, for example, the disk space used on a machine. And here, the disk is almost full, so that's why the state is critical. You can also add additional keys if you want to this event. It's arbitrary keys, like, I don't know, environment, country, zone, location, as you want. And Riemann has tons of integration. You can send events to Riemann from various languages like Java, Haskell, Golang, Python, Perl, Rust. You have Riemann integrations in a lot of monitoring tools. For example, agents like CollectD or Telegraph, which are tools you can install on your servers to gather CPU usage, RAM usage, monitor processes. And you have also tons of plugins available on these tools. You can make them speak with Riemann and send their data as Riemann event. You can also ship logs to Riemann, and a lot of logs agents like Logstash or FreeND or SysLogNG can send their logs to Riemann. And finally, you can also consume Kafka events, for example, from Riemann. You have also Nagios integrations. So it's a huge ecosystem, which is nice because you can really use it a bit everywhere if you want to do monitoring. And then Riemann receives events. Riemann is able to do computations on the fly in real time on these events. For example, compute rates, percentiles, do complex event processing, update keys, add keys, add tags to events. It's totally free. It's very powerful. You can also forward then these events, for example, to time series databases like InfluxDB, Graphite, or cloud services like Datadog. So for example, you could collect metrics with CollectD or Telegraph, do some computation with Riemann, and then forward that to a time series database or a cloud service. You can also forward things to Elasticsearch, for example, or fire alerts to cloud services like PagerDuty or OpsGenie, or send emails. For example, if your infrastructure is down, you could detect that with Riemann. Or if an application is using too many memory or a disk is full, you can trigger alerts with Riemann. And Riemann configuration is closure code. It's pure closure code evaluated at runtime with the closure eval function. This is a small snippet of Riemann configuration, which, as you can see, it's closure. And it starts with streams to define the stream. And then you can compose actions in order to do things on events. So for example, here I have a where action, and this action will only keep events with the service key equal to disk percent used. So it's a regex, which only service values, which will match the regex, the regular expression, and with metrics greater than 80. And when it happens, I want, for example, to send an email to alert at mcorbin.fr. This is a very simple snippet, but you get the idea. You write in a sort of closure DSL streams, and then events will flow into the stream, and you can then forward the events to external systems or trigger actions. And Riemann is powerful. As I said, you can do tons of things with it. You can, for example, work on time windows, for example, buffer events during 1 minute, and then do computation of them on them. For example, compute percentiles, max values, mean values, average, rate. You can also work on state changes. If you have events with a state key to OK, and then the next event state is critical, you can detect this state change and do an action based on that. You can also do correlation between events. It's super important in monitoring because today we have a lot of clustered applications. You know, we have Kafka clusters, Cassandra clusters, Kubernetes clusters, or we have multiple instances of the same application running on multiple hosts. And you want to be able to correlate events between multiple hosts. For example, to know if the load is correctly spread between hosts, or to see if one node is does not have good metrics. You know, one node in a cluster could have an issue, and you could detect that by comparing its metric with the rest of the cluster. And you also have tons of functions to manipulate events. As I said, you can tag events, add new keys to events, remove keys, change the value, update it. It's totally free. Because Riemann can be extended. It can be extended with Clojure, actually. You can build a jar and pass it to the Riemann ClassPass and then use it in your streams. And it has a nice language to define stream processing computation, which is Clojure. It also has a publish subscribe system. I will show you that a bit later. And an index. The index is a very interesting thing in Riemann, but again, I will show you that in Mirabel later, how it works, because Mirabel also has these things, PubSub and index. And finally, Riemann has good performances. It's on the Java virtual machine. It uses Netty, Protobuf. It implements backpressure. And it's easy to have Riemann instances on commodity hardware receiving, I don't know, 10,000 of events per second or 100,000 events per second. But I'm not here to speak about Riemann, but about Mirabel. Mirabel is a tool inspired by Riemann, and I actually reuse some code from it. For example, the TCP server in Mirabel is the Riemann one. I wanted to keep the Riemann philosophy in Mirabel, so the network protocol is the same. You can use all the Riemann tooling, all the Riemann integrations with Mirabel, because the network protocol using Protobuf is exactly the same. I wanted to fix the main Riemann issues. As I said, I contributed a lot to Riemann at some point. I was not happy with a couple of things, but it was not really possible to fix them in Riemann without a full rewrite. And this is what I did with Mirabel. I started from scratch and tried to fix these issues. I also added a lot of cool features. And it's, as always, free and open source with the same license than Riemann, so Eclipse public license. This is a simple Mirabel stream. So as you can see, it looks like Riemann, but it's not Riemann. It starts with streams, then stream to declare a stream. I pass to stream an hashmap, a Clojure hashmap with name, a name key, which is the name of my stream. So for example, here my stream is named request duration. And then I have a where clause. And here I want to keep events with service equal request duration. So only events with this with the service key equal to this value, request duration, will go through the rest of the stream. Then I want to only keep events with metric greater than 1.5. Then if the metric is greater, I will update my event to assign to the state key the value critical. And I will log this event as error in Mirabel. I could, for example, fire an alert in PagerDuty. So it's a very simple stream, which could, for example, alert if a request duration on your service is greater than a threshold. So it looks like Clojure, but it's not like Riemann, because as I said before, in Riemann, the configuration is Clojure functions, which are evaluated directly. In Mirabel, this configuration is compiled to an EDN representation. So my previous stream, for example, will be compiled to EDN. I will show you some example a bit later during the demo. It will be clearer, but it's important to know that it's not like in Rayman. You could even write the EDN directly if you want to, and not use the Mirabel DSL. But yes, it's EDN which is used by Mirabel. And why use EDN? Because EDN is serializable. The definition can be easily passed between systems. Mirabel, for example, has an HTTP API to dynamically create streams. It was not possible in Rayman because in Rayman, it was code, functions, and so on. It was hard to manipulate and pass between systems. Another thing, EDN is comparable. In Rayman, when you do a reload of your configuration, for example, you update it and you reload it, you define a new stream, for example, all current stream states are lost. For example, if you buffer events during 5 minutes in Rayman, you do a reload, all the states, the stream states, the buffers, the windows are lost. And so you could lose events like that. In Mirabel, I compare the configuration when it reloads, and I will only reload streams which were updated. It means I will never lose state during a reload. And finally, EDN is, I can statically analyze EDN. It's easy to parse, especially from closure. And for example, I'm currently working on the GraphViz integration with Mirabel in order to be able to generate the graph of computation from a Mirabel configuration. So it's really nice to have this intermediate representation of streams, not only have functions, like in Rayman, but have EDN. It's very, very easy to use and to parse and to use in various systems later. Also, in Mirabel, you don't have side effects. You don't have global side effects like in Rayman. In Rayman, a lot of streams use the Rayman internal scheduler. For example, when you define the windows in Rayman, so streams which buffer events for some times, you have an internal scheduler which will tick, you know, for example, every 1 minute to flush events. In Mirabel, it does not work like that. All streams and actions in Mirabel use the event time as a clock. It means if you don't send events, nothing happens. Your stream time will not move. Your stream clock will not move. It means, and it has an interesting property, the same events in the same order will always produce the same result, which was not the case in Rayman. In Rayman, you have side effects because of the schedulers. In Mirabel, it's not the case. It's interesting. Why? Because in Rayman, you are limited to real-time streams processing and not in Mirabel. In Mirabel, you can have multiple streams working on various sources of events. You can have your applications and servers pushing real-time events to Mirabel, to do real-time alerting, real-time computation, route events between systems, route events to a time series database. But then you can have another stream in the same Mirabel instance or even on another Mirabel deployment somewhere else on another server, which will work with all data. You could, for example, define a stream and then every day do a query to a time series database, extract some data from, for example, the previous week and re-inject them in this stream. And everything will work as expected because the stream clock is not the real time of your machine. It's the time of the events. So you can work also on all data in Mirabel. Another example, if you consume things from a message bus like Kafka, if you stop consuming, in Rayman, it's an issue. Because when you restart, you will have a weird side effect because the event time in Kafka is not the same than the current time on your machine. In Mirabel, it will work as expected because if you stop consuming a Kafka topic, for example, from Mirabel, nothing will happen until you start consuming again. And each stream in Mirabel is independent. It has, as I said, its own clock, its own index. More on that later, I will explain what is an index. And you can even specify when you send an event to Mirabel on which stream it should be sent by setting the stream attribute on the event. can, for example, create a stream named foo, and when you send an event, set the stream key to foo. And there is no side effects between streams, never. They are completely isolated. Multiple dimensions. Riemann actions almost only work on the host and service dimensions. But today, if you are used to monitoring tools like Prometheus, you may know that in the monitoring space, we use a lot of dimensions for our metrics. For example, metrics have tags or labels. I don't know how it's named. It depends on the tools, like environment, zone, region, application, host. And it's free. Usually, you can put what you want. You can have a lot of tags on your metrics. And Riemann was not good at that. For example, it was very common in Riemann to encode the dimensions in the service key. It's why I show you here at the left of the screen, I have a Riemann event with host server 1, serviced request duration prod P99, and metric 1. This event in Mirabel would look like host server 1, service request duration, and then I have a new key environment for prod, a new key quantile for 0.99, and a key metric. And it's way easier to work that way. And it's also nice because most monitoring agents today expect support for this kind of free labels. You know, you can put whatever you want as labels, as keys in an event or in a metric. Another thing, in Mirabel, there is a clear distinction between streams, so computation, and I/O, so pushing events to external system. There is a dedicated configuration file for I/O. It was not the case in Riemann. Everything was mixed, and it was easy to shoot yourself in the foot. Here, for example, I have in a configuration file, which is EDN again, an InfluxDB client configuration, so an I/O named InfluxDB with some config. And then I can reference this I/O by name in the push I/O action in my streams. And every time an event arrives in the push I/O, it will be forwarded to InfluxDB. It's nice because reloads and stuff like that will not impact I/Os. In Riemann, it was more difficult to do. Now the index. The index is a hash map, and each stream has a dedicated index. The latest event for each key is kept in the index. So I have a Mirabel stream here named foo, and I have an index action, index function, and I pass to this index function host and service. Every time an event arrives in the index function, the host and service values will be extracted and used as key for the event in the index. So an example here. It's a representation of the index. It could look like this, for example, a simple hash map with keys and values. And I could have a key host server 1 service CPU percent, and another key which is a host server 2 service CPU percent, and so on. And the values are the events associated to these keys, the latest event associated for this key. And as you can see, each event has a time. It's a time the event was sent by your client, and a TTL, a time to live. After a while, an event will expire and will be removed from the index. If the current stream time is greater than the event time plus the TTL, the event will be considered invalid and removed from the index. You can detect that in Mirabel. Another example here with a stream. My stream starts with a not expired action, and this action, not expired, will only keep events which are not expired. Then I call a stream named Reaper. It's also a stream which exists in Riemann, which will check every 5 seconds in the index for expired events and remove them. Then I index events by host and service. And then I have another action in my stream, which this time will only keep expired events and log them. It's interesting because like that, you could detect a source which stops emitting. If you have one server, for example, you monitor it and it stops emitting metrics, you could detect that with expiration. because you will at some point have an expired event for this for these metrics. Mirabel has an HTTP API. You can create streams from a configuration file, but also from the API. So you can, for example, create a stream, send some data to it, and delete it. You can also send events using the HTTP API. It's not very performant because TCP on Netty and Protobuf is way more powerful, but it's useful for systems or clients or languages which does not support Protobuf. It's always nice to have an HTTP endpoint for this kind of things. And finally, you can also query the indexes. I will show you that during the demo, but the previous index I show you can send queries to see what is in this index. In Mirabel, everything is testable. I worked with a lot of monitoring tools, especially when I was a system administrator, and a lot of them were not very good because it was not possible to write tests. And I don't know for you, but me, I'm on call, for example, and it's very difficult for me to write an alerting rule which can wake me up or wake up my coworkers and not be able to test it. And in Mirabel, you can test your streams. You can test everything in Mirabel. And tests are executed in isolation. They are easy to be defined. I will show you an example in the next slide. And by default, IO actions are automatically removed during tests. So for example, if you forward events to InfluxDB, Datadog, or stuff like that, you probably don't want to have that running during your tests because you don't have to set up a full environment just to launch any tests. So by default, this IO will be removed from the test. An example. This is a Mirabel configuration, which is a bit more difficult than the previous one. I have my streams function to indicate it's the beginning of a configuration file. Then stream, name, person types. It's my stream name, person types. Here I filter events by service name. Again, I will keep only events with service equal request duration. Then I will build a fixed time window, so I will buffer events during 60 seconds. And after 60 seconds, I will flush these events to the next step, which is call person types. Call person types receives a list of events from my fixed time windows action, and we compute person types, quantiles on this event. So for example, I want the 0.5, 0.75, and 0.99 percentiles for these metrics. Then I have a where clause, and for example, I want to detect if my quantile 0.99 metric is greater than 1. If it happens, it means I have some requests which are slow, for example, and I want to detect this issue. If it happens, I update my event with state to critical. I will record my event in a tab. It's also something from Riemann, this name tab. I will record my event in a tab named alert. Tabs only work in test mode. It's discarded in production, I mean. And I will, for example, push an alert in PagerDuty. And I want to be able to test this stream. This is how I do that in Mirabel. In Mirabel, the tests are written in EDN again. So for example, here I want to test my percentiles stream. And I will define the inputs for this stream. For example, I will send a couple of events with service request duration and some metrics. And my test engine will inject in Mirabel these events in order. And then I can specify in my test file, in the tab results key, what is expected in my alert tab. So for example, if I send these three events in Mirabel, I expect to have in my alert tab here, named alert, service request duration, metric 1.2, indeed it's greater than 1, that's why we will want to be alerted for that, and state critical, the state was updated. I will go back to the previous slide. As you can see, the tab name alert is the same name than in tap result. I reference my tap name in the stream. And you can test things like that. You put tap in your configuration, and then you inject events with configuration files, with test files, I mean, in Mirabel, and you see what is in the taps. So everything is testable like that. You also have a publish-subscribe system in Mirabel. You can subscribe to channels using a WebSocket clients. There are two ways to subscribe to Mirabel. The first one is subscribing to an index. Every time an event is indexed, you can subscribe to this event. And I show you that with I have a small script which is named WebSocket.py. It's in the Mirabel repository actually. And I subscribe to a channel named index dash name of my stream, so index foo, for example, and I send a query always true. Always true is a query which will match all events. So like that, every time an event is indexed, I have it in real time in my terminal. I can also use the publish action to publish an event to a channel. So for example, if I call publish my channel, all consumers which subscribed to this channel will receive the event. And again, I can do that with my WebSocket script. If I pass the option dash channel, my channel, and query can be, for example, end service bar metric greater than 10. Every time an event matches this query, I will receive it. It's nice because it means I can move data between systems like that. If I want, I can have some consumers consuming Mirabel, sorry. I can see exactly what happens in my system. For example, imagine you have a production issue. You could subscribe to Mirabel, see your events, and then you fix the issue, and you can see in real time if the events are okay. You can also use that to monitor Mirabel if you want to. For example, subscribe to things and see and do some checks on the events. You can, like in Rayman, extend Mirabel. You can define your own I/O, your own integration. For example, Mirabel supports a couple of time series databases today, but you could add support for another thing if you want to. You can define your own actions, and then you can use them in the DSL. You do all of that in Clojure, of course. And possibilities are infinite. You can use the whole Java virtual machine ecosystem in Mirabel. And it's nice because on the JVM, you have everything you want, integration with everything. So it's nice to be able to use everything and extend the product. Mirabel today has 62 built-in actions to manipulate events, do time windows, various kinds of windows, to correlate events between each other, do mat operation, move events between streams, and so on. And it supports InfluxDB, PagerDuty, and log2file as I/O. What I plan, I will work on more integrations. Alert Manager, for example, which is a tool a bit famous in the Prometheus ecosystem. I will add support for Alert Manager in Mirabel. And I would also like to work on the Graphite integration. I plan to do some internal refactoring to improve performances and also improve usability. I want to have better error messages. Error messages are always an issue with Clojure. It's the same thing with Mirabel. It's not a surprise. I want to work on the CLI and have a better development workflow for Mirabel users. I also want to do more documentation and show more use cases and write a bit about what are the strengths of Mirabel compared to other monitoring tools. Because I think Mirabel has this, like Rayman, has its place on the monitoring space. It's tools which are not common, you know, it's not every day you see a tool with a configuration which looks like Clojure, but it's very powerful and you are lacking this kind of tools. I think stream processing engines for monitoring is nice, but other tools are sometimes very difficult to set up. Mirabel is just a jar. You start it and you can use it. I'm also thinking about new stuff. And the most difficult thing, of course, is having feedbacks about the tool and build a community, as always. I will do a demo because I think a demo is important. First, do you have questions on the slide?
I actually have like a bunch, but maybe let's just do the demo and then we can go into QA after
Ok,
that.
ok. So let's start this Mirabel demo. I have one Mirabel instance running. It does nothing, it does not have any configuration for now. I have also a small background script running and pushing events to this Mirabel instance, and this script simulates some applications and servers pushing metrics into Mirabel. But as I said, Mirabel does not have any configuration for now, so it's doing nothing. Let's go back on Emacs. I will work on some events and I will write some streams to do computations and alerts on these events. The first type of events Mirabel will receive in this demo is this one. It represents the memory usage for a host, for a virtual machine or a physical server, for example. So it has a host key, server 2, a service key, memory use percent, a time, 1, and a metric, 10. So this event means at time 1, the memory usage of my server 2 was 10. Let's do some computation and alerting on that. First, I will declare a new stream in Mirabel, name memory, and with default true to use it by default for my events. I will now filter events by service to only keep events with the service value equal to memory used percent. Then I want to do some alerting. I don't want to alert on a spike. I want to alert, for example, if the metric is greater than a threshold for a certain period of time, for example, 30 seconds. And of course, I want to do this computation by host. I don't want to send an alert, for example, if multiple hosts has a great, a big RAM usage. I want to do this computation on a period of time by host. And I do that in Mirabel with the by action. By host will split the stream for each host it receives. Like that, I know that everything I will write after by will be by host. Now, let's use above DT with the values 80 and 30 in order to only keep events if my metric field is greater than 80 for more than 30 seconds. If it happens, I want to send an alert, for example. I will do a with state critical in order to modify my event state to critical. And for example, I want to test this alert, so I will write the event into a tab named memory used percent. And I will, in that case, publish this event in a new channel in order to be able to subscribe to them later. So I'm not in a real production deployment. I could, for example, send an alert to PagerDuty or a service like that. But here I will only use the publish subscribe mechanism to show you that I can subscribe to alerts. Okay, I have my stream. It's a very simple one, but it's something. And now we want to test it. It's always interesting to test its monitoring system, and Mirabel allows that. I will open a new file. So I already wrote the test suite for this test. I will zoom a bit. So I have a test here for this stream. The test is named memtest, and I have some events as input. Events as they have a host, service, and metric and time keys, of course. As you can see, the time is increasing. And we want to test if I have an alert if my metric field is greater than 80 for more than 30 seconds. And this is what happens for these events. As you can see here, the metric field is 90, this one 81, this one 90, and the time for these events starts at 70 and ends at 110. It means it's greater than 30. The duration is 40 seconds here. So I expect an alert for this event. In the tap results, I will put what I expect in my taps. So here I have a tap named memory used percent. And I expect on this tap, one event, this one with state critical. Okay, let's test that. I will go back on my terminal. I will first do a Mirabelle compile in order to compile my configuration and see if it's valid. It is. You can check the compiled version of the stream in this file, for example. And as you can see, it's compiled as EDN. So it's easy to read. You could even write this file directly if you want to and not use the Mirabelle DSL, but I find it easier to use the DSL, of course. So my stream is compiled. Let's launch the test. I will do a Mirabelle test. And it does not work. So maybe I did an error somewhere, a typo. Let's check this stream. Memory use percent, it's okay. I'm checking what could be wrong. That's why it's important to always test things, because you can have surprises sometime. Ah, I found my issue. Here, my tap name was incorrect. Let's compile and test again. Now it works. As you can see, I see all tests successful. My tests were okay. I can make these tests fail if I want to. For example, let's modify this host from server 1 to server 2. Let's launch Mirabelle test again. As you can see, the test fails because expected host server 2, actual host server 1. So Mirabelle gives you nice error messages when the test fails with the test name and the tap which was invalid. Let's fix this test. Run the test again. Perfect, it works. So I will now do a Mirabelle reload in order to reload my Mirabelle configuration, and as you can see, my new stream memory was added to Mirabelle, which is cool. Okay, but I want to do more. I want to do more on this event. It could be interesting, for example, to compute the percentiles, the quantiles for this metric. For example, let's imagine you have 100 hosts and you want to see the distribution for the memory usage. So we want to compute percentiles for this host for the RAM usage. So I'm still on my where clause, and I will add a new substream, you know, to this where clause. First, I start with coalesce. Coalesce is an action which will keep the latest event per host and flush this list of events every 10 seconds. It means every 10 seconds, the stream, the actions after coalesce will receive a list of events containing the latest RAM event, the latest memory use percent event for each host. After a while, when an event expired, it's automatically removed from coalesce. So if a host stops emitting, for example, you remove a machine, it will be removed automatically from Mirabelle. So I have my list of events.
and I want to compute the percentiles on them. Let's compute the 0.50, 75, 99, 98 and 99, for example. And I will also update for this new event the service value to memory used percent quantile and put that in my index, in my stream index, host service quantile. Okay. Okay, better than that. Let's compile this configuration. It's compiled, and now I will enable virtualenv. Okay, it's compiled. My stream was modified. I have to reload before. Okay, as you can see, I have a message saying reloading streams memory because Mirabel detecting a change. And I will now subscribe to some channels to show you how the WebSocket and the pub systems works on Mirabel. If you remember here, I publish my alerts in a channel named alerts. Let's subscribe to this channel. So I'm just doing websocket.py with the channel option set to alerts. My I have a script running in background and sending fake events, and we can see that some events matches the stream's condition, and I receive some alerts in real time. And you can also see in the Mirabel logs that I have a new WebSocket subscription for the alert channel. So I have my alerts. As I said, in real life, you could push these alerts to PagerDuty, for example. And the state is critical, and everything seems okay. And as you can see, the metric field is always greater than 80, because this is what we configured on in Mirabel. Now I will subscribe to something else. I will subscribe to my stream index here to see the result of this computation. Computing the percentiles for the memory use percent events. So I can subscribe to my index. It will be named memory index because memory is here the name of my stream. I subscribe to it and I start receiving events. Every time an event is indexed into the index, I will also receive it on my channel, and so I will receive it on my Python client. And we can see the events, our memory use percent quantile events seems okay. And we can see that, for example, for the quantile 0.50, we have a metric at 67, and for the 0.75, it's 84. And same actually for the 98 and 99 quantile. But we see it works. Again, in a real production deployment, I could, for example, forward all my events to InfluxDB here to have all my raw events on my time series database, and then also at this level push my new events, memory use percent quantile, into InfluxDB. It could be also another service, a cloud service like Datadog or something like that. So push my new metric in InfluxDB to be able to retrieve it later. Okay, this is my first stream, and it's already interesting, but I think we can do better with Mirabel and work on more complex metrics. This is my second use case here. I will work on a metric representing HTTP responses. usually on your application you have counters which counts the number of HTTP responses, for example for an HTTP server, by URI, so by path, for each status code, by method, and by host. This is what these events represent here. For example, here we know that at time 1, for the URI slash foo on my application, I had 100 responses with status code 500 for the method get. And this counter will always increase. Every time a new HTTP response is generated and sent to a client, the counter will be incremented. So if I graph this this matrix, it will grow forever. Usually what you want to do is compute the rate of errors, for example, or the rate of HTTP responses per URI, status, and method, and per host, of course. This is what we will do here. I will create a new stream, named HTTP response, for example. And I do it on the same file, but I could do my streams on multiple files. It's not an issue with Mirabel. You can reference a couple of directories and all the configuration will be merged together. It's a stream which will be as default. Again, I want to filter my event and keep, like before, only event matching HTTP responses total for my service value. Then I want to do some computation, but again, I want to do that by host, URI, status, and method. I don't want to mix, for example, 200 and 500 status codes, or mix get and post methods. I want the rate by host for each URI, status, and method combination. And now I will use the DDT Mirabel action, which will compute the rate of events based on these events, the rate of HTTP responses, sorry, based on the events. So it will convert this always increasing counter to a rate. We will see that in the test a bit later. I have my events rate, my responses rate. So I will update my service value to HTTP responses rate, for example. And then I will put that on my index and I will index it by host, URI, method, status, and also service. Like that, I will be able to see what happens on my system and also subscribe to it if I want to. And then I want to send an alert, for example, if my my error rate is greater than 1 for the HTTP status code 500, for example. In reality, you probably want to alert on all status code and not only this one, but for this demo, we can do like that. You could maybe write a where clause to match a list of status code instead. If it happens, I want to set my event's state to critical. And again, I will create a tap in order to save my events for tests. I will name it HTTP resp alert, for example, and again publish in the alert channel my alert. Again, you could use InfluxDB, PagerDuty, or stuff like that to store your computations, store your metrics, or page someone. Okay. I have my stream. It's time to test it, as always. So let's open this test file. Again, I already wrote it. Okay. I have my inputs. As you can see, my inputs have service HTTP responses total and URI status method and metrics and time and host also. And I want to see if I receive an alert, if, as I explained before, my error rate is high for 500 status codes. And this is what happens here. Because here, as you can see, we have at time 10, we have metric 11 for status 500. And at time 20, so 10 seconds later, my metric is 30. So in 10 seconds, I had on my counter 19 new errors, and the rate of events will be greater than 1. And we can verify that with this test: host server 1, service HTTP responses rate, on my HTTP resp alert tab, which is referenced here, and my metric is indeed 19 divided by 10. It's because I want to divide the number of the difference between this metric and this one, so 30 minus 11 divided by the time between these two events. And this is what DDT here is doing actually. It converts an always increasing counter to the rate of events, of course, approximately. And this is what I do here. Let's launch this test. And as you can see, the state was also updated to critical because this is what we do here. Let's do a Mirabel compile first to see if my streams works. Okay, I did a typo somewhere. I have an error in my where clause. Let me find, yes, it's here is greater than one. It's greater than equal would be like that. So the error messages in Mirabel are not quite good today. I'm still working on having a nice developer experience. But as you can see, I quickly find the issue because I knew that it was in my where clause because of that. Okay, now it's compiled and it's successful. Can launch my tests. It's failing. I probably did a typo again. Let's compare the two events. So this one, service HTTP responses rate. Ah, here. I did a typo. I'm missing a S here. Response and not responses. Let's fix it. And you know, it's really the proof that a monitoring system should be tested because it fails again. Probably another typo, because if you don't test your monitoring systems, you will do errors like that all the time. It's super easy to do a typo when you work on metrics, so it's really important to be careful about that and always test your system. And it fails because I forgot to compile between the two test runs. So now it should be good. Okay, all tests successful, so it work, and I can do a Mirabel reload to reload my configuration, and you can see that we have a message saying adding new stream HTTP response. Okay, so it's working, and I can subscribe, for example, to my index. Let's subscribe to this index and see if I compute correctly my HTTP response rate. So I'm subscribing to the index. I wait a bit for events. I think the name is good. Yes. Okay. I'm receiving events. As you can see, my service is HTTP response rate because this is what I specified here with the with action. And the value is 3 dot something. So as I said, I'm sending random events with a script. But trust me, it works, and we can verify that actually with the test. We already did it. My test files are easy here. It's not. I don't have a lot of events. I don't test all every combination of events, you know, in a real test, I will also send 200 requests on method post, for example, on various queries from various hosts. And it's EDN, so you could even generate those tests from Clojure or another language because it's easy to convert JSON to EDN, for example. So I'm sure you could do, for example, property-based testing with Mirabel in something. It's something I'm thinking about and could be a nice addition to the product. Okay, so I want now to show you a bit the Mirabel API. I think I should have some curl command here. I will go back on my terminal. I used the configuration file here to define streams, but you can define streams dynamically using the API. For example, here I want to list my streams, so I do a curl API slash v1 slash stream. I have two streams, memory and HTTP response. And I can, for example, see my stream definition. Ah, it's a dash. So my current stream definition and configuration for HTTP response is that. It's in base 64. So for example, I can do gq.config and then base 64. I will ignore garbage because I'm sure the encoding. Okay, and as you can see, I have my ADN definition of my stream, which is actually the one I would have in my compiled versions, my compiled config file. So it's this definition. I can get it from the API. And I can also create a stream like that. I can create a stream dynamically in Mirabel, inject some events to this stream. In real time or not, and then delete it when my computation is over. As I said during the presentation, Mirabel is not limited to real time stream processing. The stream's clocks are based on the event's time, so you can work with all data in Mirabel. You can extract data from last week, for example, or from yesterday, and create dynamically a stream, inject some data on it, do some computation and then delete the stream. And it's very interesting, I think, because with the same language, a stream processing language, you can do real-time stream processing and analytics on all data. Mirabel also exposes some metrics on slash metrics. So it's metrics on the primitives format. You have tons of JVM metrics about garbage collection, the memory used, the size of the heap. And you also have some metrics about the streams, the stream processing engine, for example, the duration of events, you know, the duration of the streams, you know, the times an event takes to be executed in the stream engine, the streaming engine, and also some metrics about the HTTP API. Duration, rate, and here I also have metrics per HTTP method and query, of course. So Mirabel is very powerful. You can really do tons of things with it. For example, I could write a stream named alert, and instead of which will, for example, publish my alerts in a channel and maybe send events to PagerDuty, and I could here, instead of doing that here, call re-inject alert, and events will flow from this stream to this one. So you can plug streams together, which is very interesting, and like that have a nice way of isolating computation. You know, you can have one stream for alerting, one stream for some kind of computation, one stream for publish subscribes channels, and then move events between streams. Okay, this is the end of the demo. I hope you enjoyed it. And don't hesitate to give me feedbacks about the tool.
But I have nothing else to say.
Cool. Thank you
so
much.
I hope it was
so
interesting.
Absolutely. I wrote a few questions while you were talking, but I would first ask the room here. Anybody has any question for Mathieu? Don't be shy. All right, let me just break the ice. So first thing that I can think of when thinking of deploying a service like Mirabel, can it run in some sort of highly available or clustered fashion?
Like Riemann, the answer is by default no. The main strategy for Riemann and so for Mirabel, for me, is either to use a tool like Kafka. So you push your metrics to Kafka and then you consume them from one or many instances of Mirabel. It may work. Or have a tool. You can do that with Riemann. It's not yet implemented in Mirabel, but you can in Riemann, you can have one Riemann instance forwarding events to multiple instances, so I have a sort of load balancer for events. I also know that some people are using HAProxy in front of Riemann, so it should also work with Mirabel because it's the same network protocol and the same TCP server, in order to load balance between servers and switch to another servers on downtime. So by default, it's not supported. Maybe one day I will work on that, but distributed systems are hard. And that's why today I prefer to focus on the tool itself and rely on stuff like Kafka or load balancing strategies and not implement that right now in the tool itself.
Yeah, clear. That's definitely, I know distributed systems are actual rocket science, and you have been inspired by a tool from Kylie Kingsbury, which is also very much into distributed systems. Did you receive any feedback from him on Mirabel?
No, not from Kyle. I received some feedback from some Riemann users. And to go back on distributed systems, even Kyle, which is an expert on distributed systems, was afraid to implement a distributed version of Riemann. So it's a very hard problem, stream processing and fault tolerance for stream processing systems and distributed loads and so on. That's why I'm not doing it. But for the feedbacks, no, I don't have feedbacks for now from Kyle.
Right. So in your slides, you mentioned Prometheus as a potential, let's say, competitor in the same space as Mirabel. Is there any way, also how would you see metric collection in a Prometheus-like environment for Mirabel? What would be the setup?
So first, Mirabel and Prometheus have one main big difference. Prometheus will scrap targets. It's a pool system. Prometheus, it's a central piece of software which will scrap data from exposed by HTTP servers, for example, whereas Mirabel will receive events. So its clients will push events to Mirabel. It's a completely different philosophy. I like push and stream processing. Some people, Prometheus users, usually prefer to have a pool system, so a central place which scraps everything. But by experience, my main issue with Prometheus is first networking, because in a setup like Mirabel, you can have agents deployed on your servers or your application pushing to Mirabel, and you have only one flow, from your applications and servers to Mirabel. On the other side, with Prometheus has to scrap all of your servers, all of your applications, all of your servers, demons and so on. So we have to open 1 million IP tables rules or networking rules to make Prometheus scrap things. That's why I prefer push. And it's easy to convert metrics from Prometheus to Mirabel. A lot of tools today expose metrics using the Prometheus format. I plan to write a tool which will scrape these metrics and convert them to the Mirabel format, and in order to forward them to Mirabel. But at the end, a lot of tools, for example, on the Java ecosystem, like Drop Wizard or Micrometer, supports both, actually. I don't know for Micrometer, but you could write your own integration for Micrometer, for Mirabel, but usually you have abstractions on the JVM, for example, for metrics, and then exposing metrics using the Prometheus format, or push the metrics to Riemann or Mirabel or Graphite or InfluxDB is only a configuration option. Same thing for CollectD or Telegraph. So I don't know if it answers your question.
Yeah, I think it does. Yes, definitely. Yeah. Okay. So what does make Mirabel a stream processing tool for monitoring? Can you use it for different use cases than monitoring systems?
You can because first it's generic. No, as I said, the keys here are free. Host service URI can put what you want in those keys, even the logs. Some people are using Riemann and could use Mirabel to manage logs. I'm talking a lot about monitoring because if I show you, for example, the Mirabel code base, there is tons of actions related to monitoring, which are handy, you know, for monitoring. For example, increment metrics, debug, time windows, fixed event windows. There is a lot of them, you know, tons of actions which you can reference in your streams. And a lot of them are works on metrics or works on event states. But you could use it for general stream processing. Every time you have events, every time you can represent something as events with keys, and maybe and a time and a metric field, maybe you can use the Mirabel stream processing engine. And as I said, you can extend it. You can write your own stream. You can write your own functions like that, and then use them in build the jar, pass it to Mirabel when it starts with the JVM class pass options, and then you can start using your own streams, your own actions in your stream. The whole list of actions is available on the internet if you want to check. I tried to have a good doc string, you know, everywhere. But yeah, at the end, you can use it for general purpose stream processing.
So you can ideally build, let's say, a CQRS kind of an application where the core logic is written within Mirabel.
Maybe yes, because you can really extend it as you want, but by default I built it mostly for monitoring, but at the end it's a stream processing engine, so yes. Okay. You have facilities for monitoring.
Indeed. From a scalability perspective, what would you say the computing capacity of Mirabel looks like? How many streams, how many events per second? Do you have any idea about that?
Yes. For example, the performances should be the same than Riemann because the streaming engine is very similar. And for example, we are able to, at Exoscale, we have a huge infrastructure. We are able to send if we want to. Actually, we have multiple instances, but if we want to, we are able to send all of our metrics to one Riemann server. So I don't know; it should be tens of thousands of events per second. It should not be an issue at all. When I worked before, I pushed some time. Yes. 50,000 events per second to Riemann, and Mirabel should support this kind of load. The number of streams should not be an issue. I think even one or 100 or 500 streams should change nothing. The main performance impact will come from IO, actually. For example, if you push stuff in to PagerDuty, it's an HTTP request. Of course, if PagerDuty timeouts all the time, it will slow down your the engine. You have so first you have a couple of solutions for that. Mirabel implements back pressure, so the client send an event and will wait for the answer and can have a timeout. It means if the server receives too many events, clients will by design slow down. For IO, you can do also a cool thing. For example, if I have a PagerDuty IO, which could consume a lot of which will wait a lot, you know, because it's an IO over the network, I could use an async queue. An async queue, I have to define it in the IO configuration. But it's if you know the JVM, it's a thread pool executor, actually. And everything received by this queue will be async. And like that, you will not slow down the main stream engine, the main Mirabel engine. You will work asynchronously on this queue and not impact the rest of the system. So you can make it scale like that with async queues for IO. You can then put it on it should scale. The more CPU you have, the more it will scale because you can configure the number of threads in Netty. By default, it's the number of cores of your machine. If you add cores, it will add threads. But then at the end, it depends on what you do. It depends on what you do in your stream. If you use IO a lot, if you are doing, for example, if you define your own streams and you do a lot of computation of them, I don't know, maybe crypto, for example, yes, it will be slow, but not slower than other stream processing engines. And the JVM is very good at that.
Yeah, I see that. In my, let's say, for instance, my use case would be that I have all of my applications running within a Kubernetes cluster, so I would have to deploy, ideally I would deploy Mirabel as a deployment in Kubernetes, because that's pretty much the only runtime that we use, and then everything should be sent to this specific pod, so that then I would have to properly size the pod CPU requests so that
yes,
there's enough of them to for the tool to live and prosper.
Yes, and you can actually monitor Mirabel itself, because Mirabel actually exposes its metrics as a Prometheus endpoint, so you can monitor it with Prometheus. And you have in this metrics all the JVM metrics, of course, the heap size and garbage collection stuff and so on. But you also have metrics about the streaming engine, so the number of events per second, the duration, the quantile, the latency, I mean, of the system, same thing for the HTTP server. And I plan to do benchmarks. I just haven't found the time to do it yet. But I don't know how many applications you have on your Kubernetes cluster, but I would not be afraid to send 10,000 events per second to Mirabel, for example. It would not be an issue.
Yeah, that should be plenty. So in terms of different applications, it's actually a very little amount. We're talking over four different applications, but they have many, many, many replicas that
yes,
kind of auto-scale with traffic. So then you have potentially, in terms of runtimes, 40 different, or even actually in at peak times, we reached, I think, the 300 parallel applications running at the same time. And then if you take into account applicative metrics as well as infrastructure metrics, so one, memory and CPU per pod, then things can skyrocket fairly easily, I would say.
Yes. And me, I have my own personal infrastructure, my blog or stuff like that. I have a couple of websites which are also in Kubernetes. But I actually installed Mirabel outside of the cluster on a dedicated virtual machine. It's easier for me to scale. I don't have to define Kubernetes requests and limits for Mirabel. I just have one instance dedicated for it.
Yeah, and especially because at least in my case, we are using pretty much commodity hardware, as you called it, for our Kubernetes machines. So the actual machines have no more than I think four CPU, virtual CPUs. So that puts a hard limit on how much I can allow a pod to have. So maybe having maybe an external machine would be a better solution for that.
Yes, maybe. And for the scalability, it has to be tried. Does it support it or not?
Yeah,
Up to
that's
answer.
obviously yes, because without saying. All right, I've been hogging the radio space for a while. Is anybody else having any question for Mathieu? Either shy people or tired people, or amused people that are just standing in awe in front of your project. One of the three. All right, I guess then that would be it for tonight, I would say. So, Matteo, again, a big thank you for coming to the meetup tonight and showcasing Mirabel. That's definitely an interesting tool to keep under the radar. And yeah, hopefully, whenever I'm able to actually publish the recordings, and I've been super slow at that lately, but hopefully I will be quicker this time. That will help giving you some PR towards the global closure community. And everybody's saying thank you in the chat, by the way.
Thanks to you.
Is there so I There's of course the GitHub site, where the GitHub project for where people can look at the Mirabel source code. Do you have any special remark for contributions where people should look in order to contribute anything?
I don't have special remarks. People can always send me an email if they want more details about the implementation. My email is on the About section of my website. Or open issues. Don't hesitate to open issues. Test the thing. Write the document. Read the documentation. If you have any issue, you open an issue on GitHub, and I will answer quickly, usually. But don't hesitate to suggest things. I'm always eager for feedbacks.
All right, that said, that concludes the meetup number 139. We will be coming back online next month. It's gonna be a 140 meetup. We don't have an agenda yet, but I will try to find. I will try to keep up with good content like what we had tonight with Mathieu. So thank you everybody for coming tonight, and we will see each other next month. Thank you so much.
Thank you all.